We got tonight's speaker is John Clark. John Clark is a longtime friend of the museum. He's well known to most people in the museum, and he's a professor emeritus from mechanical engineering from the University of Michigan. He is inducted into the Michigan Aviation Hall of Fame in Kalamazoo last spring. I was honored to go down there and see him inducted in the ceremony. And he was recently awarded the French Legion of Honor. And tonight, John is going to tell us a story of the 1946 reactivation of the Michigan Air National Guard at Wayne County Airport, which is now called Metro. And with that comment, please come up here, John, and we'll turn the program over to you. I'll hold on. When it's over, I'll come back up and say goodbye.
Thank you, Randy, and good evening, everyone. And thank you for coming out. I appreciate very much your being here. The Yankee Air Museum is a very important fixture in the state of Michigan, and it's always a great pleasure to provide any service that we can for the Yankee Air Museum. Tonight, I'm going to talk not about war stories, but about post-war stories. Some of you have probably heard my war stories. I was a B-17 pilot in Europe with the 100th Bomb Group and finished 32 missions over Germany, and have in the past given quite a few talks about that particular. Thank you. But flying gets in your blood, and it was my anxieties after I was released from the U.S. Air Force in 1945 to fly military aircraft. But as you understand, in the military, you are either a member or you're not. And if you are a member, you fly, and if you're not, you don't fly. Simple as that. I had married a woman who was a military WASP. How many have heard of the WASP? Well, we met at Las Vegas Army Air Base in the war. I was transitioning to fortresses at B-17s at that time. And we sort of got acquainted, and we used to date flying fighters, by the way, out of Las Vegas. 400 gallons a date, thanks, taxpayers. But she also was very anxious to keep flying. But then when the WASPs were deactivated, it was just like my being released from the Air Force, they were not qualified to do any military flying. And Jacqueline Cochran, who was the director of women pilots, made it very clear in a rather hard-nosed letter, but an honest letter to all the ex-WASPs that there were just no opportunities on the horizon for any military flying. They, of course, could do what they could work out in the private, and maybe one out of 100 got involved some way. So when the war was over, we were anxious to fly, and we couldn't. And for the first year, I couldn't. But in the summer of 1946, I was a student at the University of Michigan College of Engineering right after the war graduated later from U of M. But in that year, 45 to 46, I was just working hard as a student, as students should do, you know. They should work hard. And suddenly, in the summer of 46, I noticed in the Detroit News, that the Michigan Air National Guard was being reactivated. And wow, that, to me, it sounded like a great idea. And Marie, who was a professional musician, was out of the state at that time at Tanglewood Music Center in Massachusetts. So she had the car, and I had to find my way into Detroit. And I've forgotten exactly where I went, but I think it was on the east side to, I think, the office of a lawyer who was Colonel Anderson, I think that was the name, and he was going to be the organizing officer for the 107th Bomb Squadron of the Air National Guard of Michigan, reactivated to guard service, which is to say it was coming under the adjutant general of the state of Michigan rather than the reserve officers in Washington or the Department of the Air Force. So quite a lot of other people also had the same idea, and Mr. Anderson's, Colonel Anderson's office was quite crowded when I arrived after buses and trains and streetcars finally got there, and got my interview with Colonel Anderson, and he said, well, we have quite a few applicants. He said, but you have multi-engine time, and a lot of the applicants are fighter pilots, bless their souls, believe me, our little friends over Europe, Mustang pilots. But the National Guard, the 107th, was going to be activated with twin-engine aircraft. The A-26 was the primary aircraft for the 107th Bomb Squadron. He said, because of that, I'm looking for people with multi-engine time. And I had about 600 hours in the fortress, 300 combat hours, and that means a lot more than those two words. Combat hours is more than just flying around the states. You encounter all manner of circumstances, some of which I think I might relate to you tonight, but we learn a lot of things that aren't in the book, so-called. So Colonel Anderson said, because of that, I can offer you a second lieutenant's position. He said, you retired or were released as a first lieutenant, but all of my openings for first lieutenants are already filled. I won't go into the way the Guard fills positions like that, but anyway, I was pleased enough just to get... I told the colonel, look, Colonel, I'll pay you to fly if you... said, I'm not the least bit interested in rank, but I do want to fly very much. And so he said, well, you're the kind we're looking for. And so report to... we had the next meeting was at what was called the Wayne County Airport. How many know where that is? Well, Wayne County Airport at that time would fit in a corner of Metropolitan Airport, but that's where it was. The National Guard had been there before the war, I think, because there was a National Guard hangar off of Goddard Road. How many know where Goddard Road is? Well, Goddard Road and Middle Belt was the corner where you turned, and the National Guard hangar was along Goddard Road about a mile from Middle Belt Road. How many have ever remember seeing the National Guard hangar? Oh, good. Okay. Well, that comes into one of my stories later on. So that's where we were housed. And the Guard was treated quite informally. I think they got a little bit more formal later on. But our training was not particularly rigorous. After all the pilots had at least 1,000 hours, many of them more than that, and many of them, I had 300 combat hours, and many had more than that, too. So they were familiar with flying, but they had to be organized into squadrons and groups and flights and so on. So we spent our time on weekends and more or less getting to know each other for the first few months, and with lectures at that hangar we talked about. And our aircraft took a little while to come in. The first thing that came were an AT-6, or a couple of AT-6s. How many of you know what an AT-6 is? Well, that's good. Probably the sweetest airplane. Is it down here someplace? Hey, let's get one out of here. They couldn't find it, but it's right here. The AT-6, I think if you talk to most Air Force pilots and naval pilots as well, because it was used as an SNJ in the Navy, as an advanced trainer. This is the Navy one. You can always tell they're yellow. Oh, nothing intended by that at all. But we got a couple of these in the fall of 46, and everyone was eager to check out on it, and it was not much of a job for that to occur. The pilots were some of them had even flown it, and we had a couple of AT-11s. I think that's a twin-engine Beech. I had about 50 hours in that in Texas just before I was released from the service. So we had aircraft they were quite familiar with, but this is a big favorite. It's a sweet airplane. It even sounds sweet. You know, it doesn't roar. It kind of flutters through the air. And it originally was designed as a fighter. When my late wife and I at Las Vegas would date, we'd date in one of these and fly it around the mountains and valleys of Las Vegas. That's a wonderful way to date, by the way. Well, the guard got a couple of these, and we all quickly checked out in it and had a lot of fun with it. It's a good airplane. Not only was it a delight to fly, but it was very, very reliable. And that's part of the issue in flying, is reliability and safety. And the AT-6 had all of that. Now, so we got time in that. And kept our meetings going. And in the spring of 1947, we began getting our real aircraft, the A-26. How many of you are familiar with Jimmy Doolittle's aircraft that he bombed Tokyo with? That's the B-25, isn't it? And you remember during the war there was a B-26 made by Martin. Well, this aircraft, the A-26, is a Douglas, and it was made to replace both of those aircraft. They had served well and served their purposes, but the Air Force felt, apparently, they needed a more powerful aircraft and one that could be heavily armed and bomb and strafe. That's why the word A was used. A meant attack in those days. That kind of service was quickly set aside, though, and in the late 40s, the designation of this aircraft, generating confusion no end, went to B-26. So the B-26 that I'm talking about in the 107th Bomb Squadron of the Michigan Air National Guard and throughout the country is the Douglas. This aircraft, I got about, I think in that year and a half I was there, a couple of hundred hours in it. It has Pratt & Whitney R2800 engines, 2,000 horsepower apiece. The B-17 has four engines at 1,200, so the B-17 has 4,800 horsepower. This has almost the same, 4,000 horsepower. And in arguably a more advanced engine, and a very reliable engine. I can testify to that in one of the stories I'll tell you later on. But that's the A-26 and the 107th got these pretty much in a hurry around March of 1947. Now, a little word about the nature of the National Guard. If you're familiar at all with the history of the First World War, America went into that war in April of 1917. At that time, the regular army units, the infantry, artillery, engineers, etc., wasn't exactly a sleepy organization, but it had not fought a war except for an excursion into Mexico to go after Pancho Villa. General Pershing covered that, but most of the soldiers and the officers were sort of barracks bound for many years. So when the war came along, the Secretary of War had to federalize the state guards. And from this state, Michigan, Illinois, and Wisconsin, I think, came the Rainbow Division. How many have heard of that? It's the 42nd Infantry Division, and they were much better prepared for action in Europe in 1917 than the regular military. Of course, the regular military quickly got into order, but the Michigan National Guard was in about the same situation post-war, from 46 to 50, because the country was a little tired of war, I guess, and they began reducing all their forces. But the Air Force wanted to have their air units as much as possible prepared for action should something arise, and you all know what happened in 1950. So we were given all sorts of privileges, you might say. Our commanding officer, my squadron commander was Colonel Armstrong, or Captain Armstrong, and he said, we want you to be ready to go to war if they call you tonight. And because of that, you can take this aircraft anywhere in the United States you want to. We'll approve any flight plan. And we want you to build up time and get ready for actual federal service, should it come. And of course, it did come in 1950. The 107th, the day after the North Koreans went south, the 107th was federalized and sent to places in the West. And I don't know exactly the history from then, because I had left the Guard in 48 to go to graduate studies at MIT. So I wasn't with the Guard when they were federalized, but I don't think any of the aircraft came back from Korea, and many of the pilots didn't either. So the Guard was pressed into service immediately, doing things, from what I understand, different than they'd even trained for. They had a lot of night operations, evidently, and they hung searchlights under the wings and had them flying just off the treetops, I think illuminating the North Korean soldiers who took advantage of the night to move from one place to another. So the 107th was put to work right away because they had a very good record and had been training and worked together and were basically a combat-ready unit by the time 1950 rolled around. Now, a little bit about the A-26. I think I mentioned it had Pratt & Whitney R-2800 engines, one of the best engines ever built, in my opinion, and I can tell you some experiences with it. It would fly at about 250 crews. A B-17 would be at 100 miles slower than that. So you see it's, and the B-25, probably 170 or so. So this was fast in cruising. And of course it had a maximum speed of whatever you get out of it, probably less than 400, but much higher than what had been previously used with the twin engine bombers. It was designed with forward-firing machine guns or a bombardier observer in the nose. A little story about that comes along later on. A single pilot and a flight engineer. I had a wonderful flight engineer, Lyle Marshall. He also will come into the story later on. And then there's a gunner in the back who operated this turret and a turret below by remote means. We never actually used that at the time I was at the Guard, but the aircraft was designed with that capability. Well, the actions that I want to tell you about, the post-war stories, didn't involve any combat experiences with the 107th, because I had left the Guard to go east in 1948. But there are a number of other stories I might want to tell you about that are perhaps of some interest to you. Captain Armstrong, my CO, I remember him saying, We want you to get as much hours in these aircraft as you can. And you can fly at any time. There'll be a crew in an aircraft ready for you. I was a sophomore in engineering at the University of Michigan at the time, and I had an A-26 and a crew waiting to my service at Wayne County Airport. It's pretty good, I thought. Of course, I did take my wife up a couple of times. That was not encouraged, but it wasn't disallowed. Besides, she wanted to get back in the air and something that really sounded like an airplane. And so we did that. So I would file flight plans. I have a group of stories to tell, and why don't I start out with I call it the flute flights. My wife was a very talented musician and was teaching as an instructor of flute in the music school at the University of Michigan, had a studio in Burton Tower, but she only had one flute. And whenever that flute needed repair, if it was sent by mail or whatever to the manufacturer in Boston, it'd be at least a week before she could get her flute back. So I suggested to her that, why don't you just let me file a flight plan for a flight to Boston and back. And so that's what we did. When her flute needed new pads or some adjustments, some of you may be flute players, you know how they have to be just top shape. She'd call the manufacturer in Boston, Mr. Powell, and say that her husband would fly the flute in to Boston Logan Airport in the morning, and could he arrange to do whatever was necessary over the lunch hour, and then John would return to your factory or your office, pick it up, and have the flute back here by 4 in the afternoon. Well, that's how it worked out. So these stories are, by the way, in my book. Some of you may be familiar with that. I call them the flute flights. I made several of them. One story on regard to a flute flight is on one of them, I filed a flight plan from Logan Airport back to Detroit and got, of course, clearance from air traffic control. That's all necessary, all part of it. But their weather predictions were not always as good as you would perhaps like them to be. So I refueled at Logan and got the flute, put it in the back, took off, and headed back towards Detroit. When I got to Niagara Falls, I noticed that, my, we're going awful slow. You know, I checked the RPM is right and everything like that. Airspeed is right. And what had happened, evidently, is that the winds were considerably higher and from the west than we had expected. So I thought of some of my experiences over Germany when fuel pressure lights started to blink red. When one of my fuel pressure lights started to blink red about the time we were passing London, Ontario. So pilots have to make decisions in a hurry and try not to make wild, ridiculous ones. I said, well, I think I better give some thought to landing in Canada, foreign country. Maybe they'll think I'm invading or something like that. But after I'd passed London, Ontario, I noticed that blinking light turned to solid red. Now, that meant we weren't going to crash right away, but I had about maybe 10 or 15 minutes of fuel, maybe less. You're never quite sure when a gauge gets down to around zero. So I quickly turned around and got out my flight chart. And if you've driven from here to, say, Toronto, you'll notice there's a double-tracked railroad from Windsor right past London, Ontario. How many have ever noticed that? It's a great compass, I tell you that. The Navy follows the railroad track, you know, all the time. That's why you don't want to fly around a track, because you run into a Navy plane. I took that chance, though, and swung the AT-6 around. I was flying an AT-6 and headed towards London. And I noticed on the chart that the airport at London, Ontario, was just north of that double track. Should be easy to find. But that's not the way things often work out. Because I had approached London, a huge thunderstorm did too. And it suddenly ran into the most heavy, drenching rain that I'd ever encountered in the air. And the AT-6 does not have a windshield wiper. So I had to crack the side window and peek out and to get some idea, see the track, see it looked like city down there. And then I saw a green light and a rotating beacon, and that was the airport. I thought, everything is just fine. Here we are. Well, you got to check those assumptions too, you know. So I approached the airport and circled. They did not have U.S. military frequencies in the tower. So all you had to do was just try and see what happened. So I looked at a runway that looked like it was probably the right runway. So I brought the six, dropped the gear, and came around and approached that runway. And I noticed the tower was showing a big red light at me. I sort of got the point. And I added power and went around. I noticed another plane taking off right where I was about to land. So I just swung out, went around. And as I was coming on what we call the base leg, the tower gave me a nice green light. And so I went in and landed, routine from that point on. But we were just about out of fuel. But aboard every aircraft in the U.S. Fleet, Air Force, there are vouchers for unexpected circumstances. Well, I called Romulus, our engineering officer, and told, his name was Arnie. I said, Arnie, I'm down in London, Ontario right now, ran out of fuel. Do you think I can get away using a voucher? He said, oh, yeah, sure, go ahead. Let them fill you up. And fortunately, they were kind of curious. They said, you're the first military aircraft from the United States that we've seen since the war. And so I said, well, yeah, that's right. We like to be friendly and so on. And so they filled me up with fuel, and I signed the voucher, and I thought, that's the end of it. Again, surprise, surprise. So I took off and flew back to Detroit and landed and checked in with our office and told them I'd used a voucher and how much it was and so on. And everything stayed right there until several months later, I got a letter from the Michigan Treasury Department informing me that the Michigan Treasury does not pay Canadian tax. $6.50. So please mail us a check for $6.50. So that flute repair was not free, you see. It did cost something. When I published my book about 15 years ago, my niece in Iowa wrote a nice letter to me and enclosed $6.50. So, all right, let's see how much time we got. Another few minutes here? Let me shift to some displays right now, and I'll go back to telling you a couple more stories. Can we go ahead? Well, that's what I looked like at one time. I show that to prove that I was young once. And Air National Guard, second lieutenant, although my Army was a high rank of first lieutenant. That's a copy of my book. All that I say tonight is in the book, by the way. Probably not every word, but the stories are all there. Now, that is the tail end of an A-26. You probably can recognize it. And it says Michigan National Guard. I checked out on that and got about 200 hours in the Guard and flew at every opportunity. One of my favorites was to... after a day of classes to come out and check out an A-26 and fly it up to the Straits, just because it's a beautiful place up there. The bridge wasn't there at that time, I've talked to other Guard members that came 10 or 15 years later than I did, and they said, oh yes, we did that, but we'd fly under the bridge. I'd remind them that, look, that clearance is 150 feet. That isn't a great feat to do that. You could hardly miss it. So that's in 1947, and there is a guard. I'm in the forward part of the aircraft. We had the guard was carried was asked to do a lot of kind of public service things that we enjoyed. We'd fly low over airports here and there where they have an opening. This particular one was opening of Grayling Airport in April, I think, of 1948. And they asked the guard to send up a flight. We sent out 12, and they didn't tell us two things. One is, we've invited every other airplane pilot in the state of Michigan to come, and our tower is not equipped with military frequencies. We didn't know that until I was leading the group, too. I looked ahead, and I thought what I saw was a beehive of bees. And, well, we were doing about 250 knots, more or less in loose formation. And so as we flew, I immediately radioed the rest of the pilots. I said, there are hundreds of small aircraft up here. Be very, very careful as we approach. And so I tried to land three times in the A-26, peeled off in the formation, went around, and on the final approach, you just about be ready to get all set to go, maybe at about 1,000 feet or so, and then you'd see some little thing floating in from the side like that. And then below him was another one. So we actually touched down a couple of times, but added power and went around. Finally, this is not necessarily recommended for new pilots. We just simply took the aircraft, the A-26, close to the landing, and then side-slipped it. We didn't go in a long approach, too many other little mosquitoes around, so we just side-slipped it right on in, kicked it out, and landed. And all 12 finally got on the ground. I was something like 25 years old, and I remember when I was 10 years old, airplanes to me were just heaven. The greatest interest in my life was airplanes. So with that in mind, we just taxied our aircraft right up next to the fence where all the people were, and all the little 10-year-old boys were there. And they had a field day. We let them climb up into the airplane, and it's all public relations, I suppose. But we had a great fun doing that. And we're there about an hour or so. One of our Mustangs went along, flown by a colleague of mine, a friend, a student at the U of M. He had flown with the 8th Air Force Mustangs. And so he gave an aerial show for them, came roaring over the field about 400 or 450 knots, and then, you know, did the usual spiral, came around, and just thrilled the crowd. And then we gathered our things together, climbed back into our aircraft, and flew. Well, we arranged beforehand. We will organize ourselves near the field in a squadron of 12 and come over the field low at full speed about, I suppose we were doing, close to 300 miles an hour near the crowd, just to give them a good feeling for what the A-26s look like in the air, up close. There's an A-26 from above. You see, it looks just like this one. You see the gun compartment and so on. That was probably taken on a flight to Selfridge Field where we would practice landings and squadron formation flying, et cetera. Oh, now this, I want you to make a note of this because I'll come back to this story. This is the Rose Bowl story. And if you will notice, that's a ticket to the 1948 Rose Bowl. Tunnel 14, row 11, seat number 4. It has one distinguishing characteristic, which is part of my story to tell you. It has not been used. Well, let's see how we're doing. Maybe this is the... let me come back to that just for a second, because I want to show you this. This is, this, again, the Grayling inauguration of the airfield. I'm waving in the air with my hand, and the man behind me is Jimmy Gannett. Jimmy and I were graduate students at Michigan. He was in aerospace. I was mechanical engineering. Jimmy stayed with the Air Force. He was in the Guard at that time, but he stayed with them. And after several years, left the Air Force and became part of the Boeing test flight. He flew with famous Boeing test pilot Johnson, I think his name was, on that famous flight when the only 707 that Boeing owned, Chip Johnson, or I've forgotten the name exactly now, Jimmy was his co-pilot. He brought the 707 down across the lake near Seattle and then rolled it in front of the crowd of people that were going to consider buying that aircraft. So the president of Boeing almost had a heart attack, because no one knew whether it could fly upside down or not. But Tex knew that it probably could. And so Jimmy had that wonderful experience. And then Jimmy went on to provide test flighting in the 727 and the 747 and other advanced Boeing aircraft, I think. He's gone now, died about 10 years ago, but had a lot of real interesting things to talk about. Whoops, this is works pretty fast. There's the, I'm in the cockpit there. I think that's either at Grayling or Jimmy and I and one other pilot were asked to perform a low flyover at Willow Run. We were both working in the Aeronautical Research Center at Willow Run, and they had a celebration of some kind. And so we checked out three aircraft and made a low pass at the hangars just on the other side. At one time, there were two hangars that were had curved roofs on them. That's where our offices were. We were doing research there at the time. So we gave them a thrill with that and landed and came in and let them look at the aircraft. I think that's me in the cockpit, and I believe that's what is what it will run. Incidentally, anything that I say that's not understood clearly, or if you have a question, just raise your hand at the time it comes up. I don't mind that at all. A-26, that's another view of it. And here are the pilots from the University of Michigan that were members of the 107th and 171st Fighter. My friend right there, flew the P-51, and he was with the fighter squadron. The rest of them were all combat veterans with at least 1,000 hours, probably 1,500 hours, a lot of it combat time, very experienced pilots. And so after the war, the Guard had a rich harvest of experienced pilots. I'm right down here. There's the 8th Air Force shoulder patch that I always wore on my uniform. Well, there's the A-26 from below. You can see one aspect of that that you might not recognize unless you're a pilot yourself. Making a belly landing wouldn't be too hard a job. The B-17 was a little that way as well. It's not part of tonight's story, but we actually did belly land in Belgium with a B-17, like a big sled. Had we been flying a B-24, bless their souls, they did a great job here at Willow Run, but a B-24 has a higher wing, and try to land on rough ground, even on a flat meadow, there's no way you can keep those wings from one of them dips before the other. And if you're doing 110 knots and your wing dips, it catches, and then you cartwheel. And almost always, a cartwheel ends up in a huge explosion. So a B-17 and an A-26 had that wonderful sled characteristics. Come to the Michigan Theater on the 9th of November this year, and I'll tell you about that B-17 landing on its belly in a Belgium swamp. Art Holt is here. Who's, yes?
What happens to the ball turret?
Well, you know, we got a lot of ball turret gunners. Oh, no. It's a very good question. And there have been tragedies, unplanned, of course. But when we crash-landed, we went through the procedure, which is everyone except the cockpit, the pilots, co-pilots, flight engineer, get into the radio room on the Fortress. And then they're double-checked that everyone is there if you got the time. And, of course, the ball turret gunner is one of the first ones to volunteer to get to the radio room. But there have been some terrible things that have happened with a gunner standing in the turret. The aircraft pilot commander didn't know it, land with his wheel, with his gun straight down, because that's how you get out. And when it hit the runway, the gunner was just cut in half by the turret. So we avoid those things, of course, we can. Okay, now let's go back to here. In the fall of 1947, the University of Michigan football team did what it usually does, of course, but it won the Big Ten championship. And that meant in those days that Michigan would then go to the Rose Bowl game on New Year's Day. Well, the word, of course, went around like wildfire, and many of the officers at the Guard, well, you saw the number of Michigan students, all wanted to figure out a way of getting out there, but most of us were poor as church mice. We couldn't afford a train, we couldn't fly out, but we got the idea, let's file a flight plan. For navigational training flight from Detroit to Long Beach. From Long Beach, we have to figure out our own way to get to Pasadena. I suppose you just follow the traffic, really, but anyway, that's exactly what I did. And my squadron commander, our flight surgeon, who was 325 pounds, three other officers all wanted to go to the Rose Bowl game. Our C-47, we had that at Romulus with the Guard. That also went out with something like 20 or 25 people aboard. I meant to tell you that Jimmy Gannett flew this a lot when he was with the Guard, and I would co-pilot with him around the country. We'd fly to pick up things in Pennsylvania, go to Florida, Mid-America, and so on. So we got quite a bit of time just in that C-47. We have one here at Yankee, and it's one of the most reliable, best aircraft ever built, still flying. And, of course, it has excellent maintenance here at Yankee, of course, as do all our aircraft. Well, my flight plan, of course, was approved. Sort of approved beforehand. And so I rounded up the crew that I mentioned. And at the 31st of December, we climbed aboard a A-26 and took off for Long Beach. The takeoff was a little bit indicative of what we might encounter later on, because we set out at the end of the northwest-southeast runway at Detroit Airport, Wayne County Airport. And, of course, I was perfectly aware of this. As the engines idle, I think we were there for 20 minutes until our flight plan, is an instrument flight plan that time, were cleared to Maxwell Field for the first leg. It took the air traffic control people a long time to clear us, because there are other aircraft, I guess, on that route. But the engine, the spark plugs build up with oil or crud or whatever it is. But still, the pilot will then, when he gets his clearance, will run the engines up for in lean to try to clear, they call it clearing the plugs. Cadets know when they're coming down from 3,000 feet in their basic training, they pull the throttle back and sort of go down on idle. They have to clear the engine, if they are doing it properly, in order to get the engine ready to really run. Well, I did that, and all the normal procedures. And on the A-26, right below the pilot's right heel, there's a little window. It looks right down on the nose gear. And because when you are sitting at the end of the runway and turning, that nose wheel can turn. And if you go to take off with the nose wheel at an angle, well, you'll either get a big surprise of leaping off to one side, which is, I've never known anyone to actually do that, but you could. But you're also putting forces on that nose gear that it wasn't really designed to take. And there have been examples of just breaking. So I, of course, checked the, it's called the pilot inspection hole. I could see that we were lined up, and advanced the power, everything in the proper high RPM, et cetera, and auto-rich mixture. And as you're about halfway down the runway, the left engine coughed. You don't fool around by saying, oh, let's just keep going. No, just cut the power right away and let the aircraft coast for several hundred yards, taxi back to the hangar, and, of course, the crew chiefs have their hearts in their mouth. What happened, you know? And so we all piled out, and I just told the chief that, well, we had an engine miss on takeoff, and so we just wanted to come back to make sure everything's okay. So the crew chief got in, ran up the engines, and he came back and said, no, everything is just fine. Probably a mixture problem, but just go through normal procedures, you'll be okay. So we taxied out, renewed our clearance to Maxwell Field, Alabama, and then took off. The takeoff was perfectly normal, and then we went on instruments and flew towards Maxwell Field, which we made in probably 3 hours, something like that. I remember going right over Ohio State Stadium in Columbus. Didn't have any bombs with us, but the thought went through someone's mind, I think. We landed at Maxwell, refueled, and flew on to Fort Worth. This is all on the December 31, 1947. And just as we had landed and went in to get a supper, a cold front with rain and sleet went through. We were inside and weren't quite aware of it, but when we went to file a flight clearance with ATC through the transient place at the airport or at the airfield, it was where the B-36s were based, they said, do you have an instrument card? Yes, I had instrument card and a lot of instrument time, so instruments was not a problem. But they said, we want the weather officer to brief you on the weather conditions. We may have to change the route because there are heavy weather approaching from the west. And the weather officer said, but I think if you went south to Austin and then over to Waco and through the Guadalupe Pass at El Paso, we were cleared on then to Phoenix for refueling, that I think you probably can make that if you can get off relatively soon and beat the weather front. So that's what we did, and that's where our trouble started. We all got aboard the A-26 and taxied out. The runway was 400 feet wide and 12,000 feet long, so you could almost taxi to Waco, but the B-36 did need that. And at the end of that long runway were several lakes. Some of you have probably been to Fort Worth, and you notice the airbase is still there, and there are lakes at the end of the runway where we were to take off. Well, we got clearance from the tower and went through normal takeoff procedures, went tearing down the runway, and I noticed that the aircraft was bouncing and hitting water, splashing up, because they didn't tell me about that. We got off all right, and just as we cleared the ground, a big red light came on the instrument panel right in front of me. You pay a lot of attention to that, you know. And what it was the bomb doors are open. Well, when you're going to Ohio Stadium, that might have made some sense, but here it made a lot less sense because our procedures were for the fellow in the back, who happened to be my squadron commander, to put the baggage up from through the bomb bay doors, up into the gunner's compartment, climb up there, close the bomb bay doors, and then put all the baggage back on the bomb bay doors. My first thought was, boy, we just put all of our baggage into those lakes. But at the same time, much more serious problems arose. The airspeed indicator just fluttered to almost zero. The altimeter was not working. Rate of climb was not working. And so I knew we had to get back on the ground. So the ceiling was about 1,000 feet, and it was snowing. And so I called Fort Worth Tower and told them that we were declaring an emergency, requested immediate clearance to land. And of course, they immediately give you that. There's no argument at all. And so we then circled, had to make sure we weren't going to stall out. So I had those R2800s probably 20% above cruising. And I was constantly checking the control for sloppiness or mushiness to make sure we still could control. And then brought the aircraft around on base leg and then final approach, downwind leg and so on. And about that point, the pilot always then lowers the landing gear. You throw your lever. And on the panel, as many of you know, on every aircraft, there are a number of lights that you have wheels to go down. We had three wheels, two mains and a nose wheel, and we got two beautiful green lights. We're waiting for that third one, you know. It didn't come. And so we had more problems than I thought we had. So we added power and just went around. It was snowing heavily at that time at about 1,000 feet. And I informed Fort Worth Tower that we're having additional difficulties. We can't get the nose wheel down. We'll be in touch and working on it, see if we can't run through several cycles to get it down. And we did that, several cycles, but it still wouldn't go down. Then in the darkness of the cockpit and the roaring of the engines and the air rushing over the aircraft, I heard in my right ear my flight engineer, Lyle, I mentioned his name a minute ago, we'll come to it. Lyle said, "Lieutenant, I think I can probably bang on that nose gear." Said, "I have a long extension screwdriver in my kit." A very experienced guy, he traveled, and I have a hammer. He said, "With your permission, I'll just break that glass below your foot." And with the light in that container, we snapped on the landing gear light, and there was that landing gear halfway up, just limp. And we tried to put it down, and you could see it trying, but it wouldn't go. We didn't know exactly why, but we suspected that it was frozen. On takeoff, water came in there, a lot of it probably, and then it froze. And once you have it frozen, there's no way you can get it to melt. all by itself because it's colder up there than it is on the ground. So Lyle Marshall, his name was, I said, Lyle, go ahead and do what you can. In the meantime, my job was to keep the aircraft flying at no airspeed, and the altimeter was erratic. And we, put on pitot heat and all that, to which is what a pilot would do. We had that experience in combat one time. That's another story, but so we're used to what we should do. But still, the landing gear wouldn't come down. But finally, after I don't know how long it was, seemed like a long time, it was probably about a half hour at the most, just as we were turning, we were circling the field all the time, just as we were turning on from the base leg on to final approach, suddenly, before my eyes, was the greatest sight that I'd ever seen, better than any Christmas tree lights I could ever imagine. Three greens right in front of me. So I just called the tower and said, we are on final approach, three greens. We will continue to land, request approval, which was automatic. And we touched down. I don't know how fast we touched down because the airspeed wasn't working, but I do know that those wheels gave the greatest screech that I ever heard in my life. So we could have been doing 200 knots. See, when there's you're uncertain of your airspeed, you always err on the side of excess speed. I may have had a little bit more excess than was really necessary, but I could feel the controls. Everything seemed to be in order. And out the side of my eyes, yeah, peripheral vision, I saw all of these trucks going backwards at such heavy, high speed. And I wonder, what are they backing up for, you know? Until I suddenly realized as we came towards the end of the runway and they gradually stopped backing up and were going forward, that they were going as fast as they could to keep up with us. So we had outrun them. And at the end of the was a big crane and two fellows in these white asbestos suits standing ready to do their job. Well, we taxied around and came to the parking place and the ramp and parked the aircraft. And just as I was looking down, a staff car drove up with a flag on the fender with a single star in the middle. That was Brigadier General Roger Ramey. I had interrupted his New Year's Eve party. So I said, well, you know, we're here, we're safe. Anything can happen. I really don't care now because we're down. But he just looked up at me and he said, everything okay, Lieutenant? I said, yes, sir. He said, good luck, and got back in the staff car and went back, I think, to his party, New Year's Eve. I should add to what some of my concerns were. We had a flight surgeon, 325-pounder in the squadron. He chose to fly in the nose. To get into the nose, he had to take off his parachute and climb in from below. And to get out, he'd have to, the parachute, he'd have to climb out first and then bring his parachute with him. Didn't seem too practical to me. So I was concerned that a wheel landing with the flight surgeon there would be a very unwise thing to do. I'm not sure what alternative we would have had if it had been a bad situation, but fortunately it wasn't. But he was there, and my squadron commander was in the back, and so the rest of us luckily got that nose gear down. And I recommended an award for Lieutenant or Sergeant Lyle Marshall, and the Adjutant General of the state did award him a certificate of merit because he did a wonderful task of not being only prepared, but with knowledge and with an idea as to how we could get out of that situation. Well, there a couple of other things I had in mind telling you about, but I don't want to bore you or keep you longer. But what happened is that the rest of the crew got commercial airlines, got to the game. Michigan won 49-0. I didn't even know about it until I got back to Ann Arbor, because Lyle and I spent all of New Year's Day running landing gear checks, blowing out the lines. The instrument people there told me that water had accumulated in the static lines, and that's why the static instruments wouldn't work. And so they blew those out, dried them all out, and then the next day, 2nd of January, we flew on to Des Moines, Iowa, where my mother and father-in-law were. We had to refuel anyway in Des Moines, and then after visiting briefly with them and getting refueled, we filed a flight plan out of Denver, some Air Force place at Denver, for Detroit. I probably should tell you this story. A day or so before, some of you think back on the end of 1947, two big storms had passed through this area, leaving behind 30 inches of snow, totally unknown to me, and somewhat unknown, I think, to the weather clearance people in Denver. So I filed a visual flight plan, leaving Des Moines Airport about 5:30 at night on the 2nd of January, 1948. By the time we got to Chicago, I began to get a little uneasy because we were down to about 800 feet. In a visual flight plan, you're supposed to be able to see the ground. And so I tried to obey that. Went over South Chicago at about 300 feet, and I smelled the stockyards. And I saw a neon sign in a bar blinking. When we reached Lake Michigan, the ceiling sort of built up a little bit. We had planned to go below Lake Michigan because we didn't have any life vests. So we went around the south end of Lake Michigan. And I remember seeing, this is my football stadium trip, I guess, because I saw Notre Dame Stadium at South Bend. Then I knew where it was. So I tuned the command radio and the radio compass into Detroit frequencies. A radio compass is a great assistance because it homes in on the station ahead, and the radio range station was right next to the airport at Detroit, the Wayne County Airport. So you just follow the needle on the radio compass, and the command radio kept getting weather reports. Well, the weather reports I was getting from Detroit was 20 miles visibility, unlimited ceiling. I was down to 200 feet over southern Michigan in snow, sleet, freezing rain. But my savior was Detroit radio. We got ice over the entire front of the aircraft. Of course, on goes pitot heat and all the usual things. But the ice built up, so that there was ice all over the cockpit and the forward part of the aircraft, and of course on the wings themselves, undoubtedly on the tail surfaces. We have lights here that shine down on the wing. We snap those on, and you could see the ice building up. This was rime ice, for those of you who are technically interested, worst kind, because it screws up the airflow over the wing. And an aircraft can stall out if you get a lot of ice there. The propellers also were collecting ice, but we could inject alcohol or antifreeze at the base of each of the propeller blades, and then the centrifugal force would carry it out and break off the ice. The ice would then hit the aircraft or sound like flak. Thought I'd right back in action again. But I could still hear Detroit radio, so I stayed with it. The ice kept building up, but I knew we would come out of it sometime. I remember somewhere south of Niles, I think, we were down to about 200 feet, and we went over a farm And you know how the farmer has that outside light? I saw the farmer walking across his yard with a pail in his arms. We were probably going so fast that he didn't look up. Maybe he didn't hear us until after we passed him. But he probably wondered, what's going on here? Well, anyway, we got to Detroit. Irish Hills are, what, 1,800 feet? Something like that. So I knew they were pretty high, and I was at 200 feet. I thought maybe we'd better veer to the north, which I did. Veered to the north, and then gradually the ice and all that, and the snow and the sleet diminished. And out the ice was covered over the whole front of the aircraft, except right about there, there was a little spot that was not covered with ice. And at least I could see that much. And I noticed Jackson, then Ann Arbor, and we came into Detroit. I called the tower at Wayne County Airport, and the tower said, be advised that the field is closed. They might have almost said, be advised that we are about to open our 88 millimeters on you. They said, we have had severe weather here. The runways are covered with ice and 30 inches of snow. So the field is closed. Well, I knew that I could go into Willow Run, and I knew that I could probably go on to Selfridge, but I was very familiar with Wayne County Airport. And in the back of my mind, I was going to do what we did in Europe. When we got back from missions over Germany, the B-17 had 2 inches of glass in the windshield. And at bombing altitude of over 30,000 feet, those glass got cold. And glass doesn't heat up very fast, as you know. I can give you the technical reason for that, but it's just slow in heating up. So when we let down into the English atmosphere, when the day was a beautiful sunny day in England, we'd hit that English moist atmosphere and instantly we'd get frost on the windshields. And we not only have low visibility, we had glare in our eyes. So we didn't complain about that, but you know what we did? We always did this anyway. If we were coming in for a formation landing, we'd fly the airplane out the side window anyway. You just fly out and keep it in a turn, and in your final turn on the runway, from the base leg, you see the runway out there, and you just keep your turn going, and then you get to recognize trees, houses, huts, and of course other aircraft parked on the hard stand, and just bring the aircraft in without even looking ahead. You don't have to. You got a compass. You can always look up, too, but that's how we landed many times in England after a mission. So I had this little postage stamp out the side of this, and I could see that much. And I told I asked the control tower, if you will turn on the floodway lights at the end of this runway. There used to be banks of floodlights on runways in those days. The runway was 6,000 feet long, and I said, if you will turn that on, I think I can probably manage to get the aircraft down. I'm out low on fuel anyway, and I've got to get down. So they did that, and I was just north of the field along what's now I-94 probably, and I saw them turn on. I saw the lights come on, the runway running northeast. So I just put the aircraft into a slow turn, losing altitude at the same time. And I'd done it so often in England in a fortress that you could just time it. So by the time you brought the aircraft out into a position, check the gyro compass for the runway, keep the floodlights in mind, ice, totally zero visibility forward, but just keep the aircraft slowly turning, losing altitude, sort of pull the throttles back. You don't want to go too slow because I didn't know how much ice was on the wings and how it affect to check the feel every if there was a response. But the tail services had no idea about it at all. And so then we approached the airport, and I remember seeing those, got in line with the runway, checked the gyro compass for the runway heading, and just eased the power back, and the floodlights went flashing by, and then we eased down on the runway. Now, I didn't want to go too fast because the tower said the runways are covered with ice. So you can't go too slow, you can't go too fast. How fast should you go? You just use your best judgment. And so we then hit at the end of the runway, and I got the biggest surprise of my life. The wheels hit 30 inches of snow that had ice on top of it. And they just broke through that crust, and we slowed up in about 200 yards. So we opened up, these are clamshell, we opened these up and looked out, and it looked like the South Pole, you know. And the meanwhile, the tower was calling madly, where are you, where are you? Said, well, we're down on the runway safely, but we are having to navigate back to the parking area. And so for the first time in my life, we flew instruments just to taxi along the runway, following the compass. And after it was about 5,500 feet, when we got to the end, they had shoveled that area, and subsequent rain had frozen. And when we got there, I could see what the tower had said was right, that it was very slippery, because on the slightest incline, the aircraft would just do this. And so we had to taxi very, very slowly. We had the canopies open, and I even was standing up. You could hold the throttles with your hand and look ahead. And brought it around to the hangar doors the National Guard hangar, brought it up the doors, and then shut down the engines. Called the tower and said, would you please inform them that we're here? But it was quite a while before they raised the duty officer. He finally came out and he looked at us and he said, where you guys been, you know? Well, it looked like something out of a National Geographic special. That aircraft had ice all over it. And they hooked up a tug and pulled it into the hangar. And they told me that by the next day, noontime, the ice had more or less gotten off the aircraft. Well, that is probably the last story I'll tell. I got a dozen others which I'll have to hold till next time. Thanks very much for being a good audience.
Any questions for John?
Yeah, of course.
Oh, right here.
Does your book go into your war, the flying you did in the war?
This?
Yes.
Yes, it's a combat diary. It's a diary I wrote after every mission, and it's published here, excuse me, with a contemporary evaluation to how I looked at it 70 years later. This National Guard is in it, too. Everything I said here is found there.
How do we obtain your book?
Talk to Steve.
That's a good question.
There are some in the store.
There's none. No. We're the museum is actually out of them, and I just talked to him tonight about us publishing his book again. So it'll be some time, but we'll have it available soon.
We probably could loan a book to someone who had an urgent need for it, such as writing a book or something like that.
Yes, right
over here. Go ahead.
I came in just a little bit late. Perhaps I missed this, but is it not true that the B-26 was a real danger to new pilots and that there was a lot of accidents in training because of the high wing loading situation?
I think you're thinking of the Martin B-26. That was called the Widowmaker. And they had to extend the wing to give it a more aerodynamic lift. I've flown in it once at Las Vegas, a very serviceable airplane. It served in Europe in the 9th Air Force, but it was considered to be a difficult aircraft to fly, which meant you had to pay a lot of attention in landing. Yes, sir.
Was the A-26 ever used anywhere in combat?
Yes, it's an interesting question because the A-26 is one of the few aircraft in the U.S. Air Force inventory that was in every war, World War II, Korea, Vietnam, what came next? And it just went out of service probably 10 or 20 years ago. Had lots of good service, and World War II, it came in towards the end.
They used them for firebombing, I think, later.
Yes, they did. Yes, they did.
Yes, they were. Oh, by the way, I do want to mention that, would you tell me your name again?
Russ.
Russ made this model for me. So isn't that a great thing to do? Thanks, Russ.
With one or two pilots?
One pilot and a flight engineer.
Okay.
We had a dual control one for training.
Now, when the bomb bay came open, did you lose all your baggage?
No, Ward had not yet loaded them on the bomb bay doors, but we sure thought we had. Yes, sir.
Yep. What service did you give to France? That they're giving you they gave you the French Legion of Merit? Is that correct?
Oh, the French Legion of Merit.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
What you're flying over France?
Yes, it was given to, I think, quite a large number of American servicemen who participated in certain, for the air units, certain air battles. They had three of them, I was in all of them. And if you did serve that way and could identify that with records, then the French consulate mailed you your, that's what this red thing is, that's Legion of Honor. The rank is that of Chevalier. Sounds pretty good, doesn't it? I think it means, what does it mean?
It's a horse instead of soldier.
Yeah, Chevalier would be a knight. That's what it's called, a knight. Yes, but I think they have given quite a large number of them out. I'm going to mount the medal, as well as the Michigan Aviation Hall of Fame thing, on my uniforms here at the museum. And the French medal is perhaps like the French are. They're very artistic, and that medal is one of the most beautiful medals I've ever seen. I'll put that on my uniform here in the museum so it can be seen. Yeah. Yes, sir.
The B-17 that flies here at Willow Run, do you ever go fly in that, and does it ever take you back, and how does it make you feel when you do it?
Yes, I've flown with the Delta captains and with Colonel Hunter, who's back here, a few times, and it's been a big thrill, and they were nice enough to take a picture of me when I was 90 years old. I'm 93 now, flying along the Detroit River, where we had a job to do along the river there. So not too many times, probably four or five. I enjoy it. Yes, sir.
Do you have any knowledge or recollection of the Packard Merlin engine?
I don't think I heard that.
The Packard built the Merlin engines. You mentioned the Pratt & Whitney.
Oh, yeah, the Packard Merlin.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Jimmy Gannett and I were working at Willow Run. We bought two Packard Merlin engines. They were powered the P-51 Mustang, and of course the Lancaster and the Spitfire. And we set them up at a test cell, not far from where the old hangar was here, on the east side of the field, back in 47, 48. We used it because it had a mechanical supercharger that could provide a flow of air for a wind tunnel. That's what we used it for. We bought two of them, $50 a piece, at Toledo, where they were built. And we used one for spare parts. And then I left for MIT a few months later, and I don't know what's actually happened to them. It was a combustion cell. They wanted airflow. Any other questions, comments? Right over here.
Did you have any interest in becoming a commercial airline pilot?
Well, the thought, of course, went through my mind and through my wife's mind, too, because there were possibilities. Some of those WASPs had 2,000 or 3,000 hours in really high-quality aircraft. In my case, when I was at San Angelo before I was released from active duty in the summer of 45, there were 500 other officers there, most of them pilots, some of them high-ranking officers, lieutenant, colonel, and above. And I had other plans anyway, and my measly 1,000 hours I knew would not really qualify for airline flying. At the same time, I had other plans, but I knew that I wasn't really prepared. So many others had many better records than I had, so I just went on with my educational plans. But when the National Guard came along, I worked that in for a couple of years. Could hardly miss that one. Any other thoughts, questions? Well, thanks very much for being a great audience.
John, thank you very much for coming. Those were great stories. We'd love to hear more of those stories. Those are the kind of things that bring you back to aviation.